Well, welcome everyone. Today's webinar, like all webinars, is being recorded and will be available for on-demand viewing through geodynamics.org. During the webinar, please use the chat window to type in your questions or communicate with others. During the Q&A session at the end of the talk, please either indicate in the chat window or turn on your microphone to notify us that you have a question. However, during the presentation, please keep your microphone muted and again, ask questions via the chat window during the talk itself. For today's webinar, we are fortunate to have Dr. Cian Wilson of the Carnegie Institute, Department of Terrestrial Magnetism. Dr. Wilson's research primarily focuses on computational methods and applications for complex nonlinear solid earth processes, including, for example, flow and deformable porous media. Dr. Wilson is also one of the core developers of the open source fluid dynamics code Fluidity and the principal developer of the open source code TerraFERMA. Today, Dr. Wilson will be discussing TerraFERMA, which provides a unique model building framework for complex solid earth processes. And with that, Cian, the screen is yours.
Introduction, and thank you to everyone else for logging in to listen today. I'm going to be talking today about TerraFERMA, the rather tortuously named Transparent Finite Element Rapid Model Assembler. TerraFERMA is a framework for rapidly building multiphysics models that is itself built on numerical software libraries like FEniCS and PETSc. We've been developing and using it for a few years, and what I hope to do today is to show some examples of using TerraFERMA, but also explain why we ended up developing it and why I think a framework like TerraFERMA is important to use when for maintaining and sharing multiphysics models. As John said, please feel free to write questions in the chat window. I have it open here. I'll try to respond to them. I would really like this to be a discussion. But I'm going to start by talking about some of those numerical software libraries in a very general sense before focusing on some examples of using FEniCS, the finite element library, and PETSc, the numerical linear algebra computational science library. I'm then going to discuss a little bit about some issues that we ran into when we were starting to use these tools. And those issues are what led us to develop TerraFERMA, which I'm then going to talk a little bit, give an example of using TerraFERMA, as well what it's like from a user perspective, and then also on the other side of the coin, what a developer needs to know about TerraFERMA. And then I'm hoping to open it up for discussion with some ongoing issues and future work that we're doing or planning on doing in the near future. So starting out just by thinking about what multiphysics, a generic multiphysics model based on partial differential equations might look like. This is my rather crude attempt at visualizing this. You have different choices to be made in each column, and going from left to right, you typically have some option system. A model will have an option system. It will have chosen some PDEs and constitutive equations. It will have defined its geometry and mesh in some way. And then given some discretization technique and choices, you'll produce discrete equations. Generally, you'll need solvers to solve. And then presumably at the end of all of this, you want to be able to visualize and verify your results. So thinking about models in general, they kind of take these different paths through all these options that are out there and available for how you implement things. And I think as a community, we've gotten quite good at being able to abstract certain steps of this from the actual model development process. So obvious examples are that many of us will be used to using tools like PowerView and MayAVI for visualization, and GMesh and Triangle and many, many others for mesh generation. So it's not necessary when you start developing a model to sit down and write your own mesh generator anymore. And in a similar manner, tools are now available so that you don't have to write your own solvers. So for instance, PETSc, Trilinux, Sundials, many others, and many other libraries that these depend on, provide some of the key components of solver functionality that we need. And similarly, libraries like FEniCS, FireDrake, DL2, and again, apologies for the many others I'm not listing here, can provide us with tools for describing and discretizing our equations. I'm going to focus on FEniCS and PETSc just because that's what TerraFERMA uses. And I'm going to start by just discussing FEniCS. So the FEniCS project is a huge project, contains several component libraries, but I'm going to focus on three key pieces of functionality that those libraries provide. The first is that it provides a high-level language called the Unified Form Language, UFL, that allows you to describe the finite element weak forms of coupled systems of equations in a very concise manner. And I'm going to show some examples of that in a little bit. It then provides code compilers that allow you to take that high-level description and turn it into finite element assembly code. And finally, it provides tools that link that assembly code with other things you need, like descriptions of your geometry or your mesh and other data structures that allow you to turn that finite element description of your problem into an actual working piece of software model. So FEniCS offers both C++ and Python interfaces. I'm mentioning that just because the example I'm about to show is using the Python interface, but TerraFERMA itself uses the C++ interface. So taking a very simple example, which I've just pulled straight from the FEniCS repo, we might want to solve a Poisson problem where we want to solve for u given Poisson's equation, so Laplace operator acting on u and some right-hand side terms. We're going to define some domain, omega, in this case just a unit square, and that domain is going to have some homogeneous boundary conditions on it, both Dirichlet and Neumann. Because we're solving this using finite elements, we're going to want to work out the weak form of this equation, so that means we're going to have to define a test function here called ut, which we're going to multiply our equation throughout by to generate the bilinear and linear forms. So the bilinear form here, we've just multiplied our left-hand side through by ut, integrated that term by parts, and the linear form is just the right-hand side multiplied by ut and integrated over the domain. Taking the script from the FEniCS repo that solves this problem, it's incredibly concise. It's less than 20 lines of actual code. It's Python. And looking through that script, we can see the correspondence between the problem definition on the left-hand side of the screen and the script on the right-hand side. So we would start by defining our geometry and our mesh, in that case, to be unit square, 32 cells by 32 cells. It's a finite element problem. We're also going to define our function space, in this case to be a Lagrange element, a linear Lagrange element, so P1 problem. We then want to take those Dirichlet boundary conditions, define where they are on the domain and what values they have. Then we need to define a test function. I'm also defining here the trial function for the finite element problem. And then also we need to provide expressions for what these f and g, which were not actually defined on the left-hand side of the screen, but are now defined in this script. Finally, we need to actually describe the weak forms, these bilinear and linear forms. And we can do that using this UFL high-level language description. So here we have the gradient of the test space, the inner product of the gradient of the test space with the gradient of the trial space integrated over the domain, which corresponds to our bilinear form. And the linear form is simply the test function multiplied by these right-hand side expressions. We're then going to want to pass that off to FEniCS to solve the problem, which they provide a wonderful syntax for doing. And it's going to provide us with the solution in this UI function, which we can then at the end output to file and visualize using PowerView or Navy or many other tools. So this example really demonstrates how concise, flexible FEniCS is. It's not a particularly relevant example for us, and more complicated examples obviously take more lines of actual script. So I'm going to be focusing on the slightly more interesting problem of infinite Prandtl number thermal convection for most of the rest of this talk. So here we want to solve for the velocity, the pressure, and the temperature given a Stokes equation and a viscosity for the velocity. We're going to impose an incompressibility constraint to get the pressure. And we want to solve a temperature advection diffusion equation given some Rayleigh number. And then, of course, we have a problem domain and boundary conditions imposed again. Now, what makes this problem more interesting than the last problem is that we have nonlinearities in this problem. So these nonlinearities arise between the different equations, for instance, because the temperature here is relying on the value of the velocity for its advection, but also potentially within the equations for a non-Newtonian rheology, your viscosity might depend on the strain rate, velocity, the stress, and introduce nonlinearities that way. So when we're thinking about this as a nonlinear problem, I'm going to think about it in terms of a Newton solver, where we're going to define U to be our vector of unknowns, the velocity, pressure, and the temperature. And then at each Newton iteration, we're going to update our vector of unknowns to a new best guess, given our previous best guess, a nonlinear residual of our problem called F here, which I'm going to define on the next slide, and the Jacobian of that nonlinear residual. So again, we're thinking about this in terms of finite elements. So we're going to talk about the weak form of that residual. We're going to define a test function for each of the components of our unknowns. So we have a VT, a PT, and a TT in this case. We're again going to multiply through our equations by those test functions and integrate over the domain, integrating by parts where necessary. So here you can see the stress term and the pressure term, both integrated by parts, and the buoyancy driving force in this equation, making up the residual component for the velocities. We then have the continuity equation. And in the temperature equation, we've multiplied through by the test function. We've also assumed here that we're using a two-level time-stepping scheme, and we've discretized the time derivative using that. So here, Ti is our most up-to-date temperature. Tn is the value at the previous time step. Delta T is our is size of our time step. And we've introduced these subscripted theta terms to represent theta-weighted versions of these variables, just to make this a little more concise. So our total residual then is the sum of these three components of the residual. And mathematically speaking, the weak form of this is very simple to write down. It's just the derivative of the residual with respect to that vector of unknowns gives us our Jacobian. So again, just like in the Poisson example, FEniCS provides us with this high-level language that allows us to describe this in a manner that is really very similar to the mathematical notation. So here for the velocity residual, we have the inner product of the symmetric gradient of the velocity test space with two times the viscosity, which in this case is going to, I'm assuming, has been defined at some point higher up than I'm showing you in this slide, times the symmetric gradient of the velocity itself. So again, just like on the previous slide, and if I flick back, you'll see that there's sort of one-to-one correspondence. We have the velocity residual, the pressure residual, the temperature residual, and then the total residual. You can imagine that describing the Jacobian for this, if you were doing this by hand, could get quite complicated if your viscosity here was temperature dependent, and especially if it was strain rate dependent, that the derivative of that with respect to the velocity would generate some very difficult terms to write out. FEniCS provides us with a syntax that means that it will go away and calculate that for us just by taking the derivative of this nonlinear residual f with respect to ui. So at this stage, we can take this description of the problem, FEniCS will go away with it, produce finite element assembly code, and assemble for us the discrete version of our problem, which will look something like this. So we have a Jacobian matrix times the update in our unknowns, and on the right-hand side, we have minus the residual of the nonlinear residual of our problem. And our Jacobian in this case is going to be this large block matrix with subblocks for each of those components of our vector of unknowns. So at this stage, we need to be able to apply the action of the inverse of this Jacobian matrix in order to find delta u. And that's when we turn to a library like PETSc. And PETSc really provides numerous tools for scientific computing. I don't even know what all of them are, but it's an incredible library. Particularly relevant here, it provides us with both the nonlinear solver when we're talking about this Newton iteration, it's providing us with an implementation of that. And it also provides a large variety of linear solvers to be able to solve this part of the problem, this part of the matrix problem. It provides efficient parallel data structures, which are very important when wanting to scale this across multiple processors. And also of importance, it allows you to select at runtime your solver configuration using either command line arguments or an input options file. And that's particularly important for when you have the sort of flexibility that FEniCS allows you to have in terms of switching constitutive equations or entire equations. You're going to need to be able to quickly switch different solvers. So you could imagine that switching from an isoviscous thermal convection case to a nonlinear, non-Newtonian might require a different solver strategy in those two cases. Also particularly relevant to us in terms of the multiphysics problems are what PETSc calls its field split preconditioners, which I'm going to discuss on the next few slides. So if we return again to this block matrix problem that we were left with at the end of our assembly in the previous example, we could look at this and just say, okay, well, we're just going to try and apply a direct solver to this. And the PETSc command line options to do that would be to set the KSP type or the linear solver type to be pre-only and the preconditioning type to be an LU decomposition. But this isn't really going to get us, you know, very good scaling behavior. It's not going to allow us to increase our problem size very much or go 3D very easily. So instead, we want to maybe try to apply an iterative solver to this matrix. But then we go and we kind of look at the matrix and we think, well, this matrix is a little bit odd because it combines both what we're used to seeing in terms of the Stokes blocks with this temperature advection diffusion block for the temperature. So this A block is going to be non-symmetric because it's got an advection component to it. The K block may be symmetric or non-symmetric depending on whether the derivative that we took during the formation of the Jacobian has strain rate dependence and velocity dependence in it. These C, not only the buoyancy, but also any potential temperature dependence, any derivatives arising from the temperature dependence of the viscosity. And similarly, these B blocks in the bottom left of the matrix contain components from the velocity dependence of our A block. So what we can, so solving this whole matrix in one straight shot is a little bit of a challenge to know how to do that. But what PETSc's field split preconditioners allow us to do is to say, okay, well, we know something about the subblocks of this matrix. let's apply solvers to those subblocks to precondition the overall larger block matrix. So to do that, I'm just going to modify the problem slightly by preconditioning it. Here I'm using a right preconditioner. So I've had to define a preconditioner for my Jacobian, which is this upper triangular matrix here. And the apart from the zero blocks down here, which we just don't use in this preconditioner, the most important change here is that I put in the standard scaled pressure mass matrix into the zero saddle point block of the Jacobian. So now if we think of, we still want to apply the action of the inverse of this Jacobian. So we're going to start by thinking about, well, what solver do we want to apply to that? And I'm going to say I'm going to apply an FGM res linear solver. And I'm going to start by applying this field split preconditioner to it. And the first step of that field split preconditioner is going to say, okay, well, I recognized before that there was this Stokes block and this temperature block. I know how to solve the temperature block. I can apply GM res with a SOR preconditioner to it. We also know how to solve Stokes blocks, particularly if this was isoviscous or temperature dependent. So at this stage, I could, for instance, apply at this level a sure solver routine to these blocks. But instead, just to hammer home the point about field split preconditioning, I'm going to carry on with this field split example and carry on down to the next level where I'm applying field split on the Stokes block. So it's now a split into the velocity and pressure. I know how to solve the pressure block because it's just a mass matrix. I'm going to apply conjugate gradients with a SOR preconditioner to that. And then just to really take this to extremes, I'm going to split this down to the level of the individual velocity components and imagine that I'm applying a multi-grid preconditioner on those. So at any point of that, I could have stopped and changed my mind and chosen something different. But if we were to follow this through, the sort of default command line syntax for that would be this incredibly long list of options that I'm listed down at the bottom of the screen. And that allows us at runtime to select what solvers we're applying at each level of this problem, what the tolerances is we want to apply, for instance, on this GM res solver. And that's incredibly flexible, but as you can see, it's a little cumbersome with this many options to set up and describe. It also depends on the code or the model that you're using, knowing what the splits are, what the different blocks of your problem are going to be in advance. There are tools out there for doing that. For instance, FireDrake has them. PETSc has its own DM. Module, I guess, or class for describing that, but it does depend on that functionality being implemented in the model. So this leads us nicely into the sort of issues that we ran into when we started using these tools for our modeling. So as you saw with the Poisson example, it's very easy with FEniCS to open up a new file, start a new problem, and in 20 to 50 lines have a description of your problem. And of course, for more complicated problems, that file becomes longer. But it's very easy to quickly generate like tens to hundreds of versions of your file or different models, and each one of those different models is a different script, a different file. And that becomes a bit of a maintenance problem, particularly when you think about things like API changes to the underlying libraries, in this case, FEniCS. So I've just illustrated this here with the superficially simple problem where the unit square function has become unit square mesh. And now you have to worry about propagating this through your 100 different versions of this or your 100 different model problems that you've rapidly generated using FEniCS. You also have an issue that with these 100 different models, you can mix and match this structure quite a lot. You can maybe define your trial function up here, higher up in the script, or your expressions right at the beginning of the script. And it becomes quite difficult to compare and contrast these models. You also run into the problem that you might have implemented, for example, you might have implemented the splits for a particular field split in one model, and then you suddenly want it in another model, which leads to some sort of dangerous copying and pasting between different scripts and different versions of this. The other issue with starting a fresh file is that verification of results from one model doesn't necessarily indicate that another model is correct. You will have confidence in the finite element assembly because that's coming from FEniCS, or you have confidence in the solver because that's coming from PETSc, but you might have made a mistake in one of yours implementing a boundary condition. That means that model is wrong where a previous version of this model, a previous file, is correct. And then the final issue that we ran into is that these command line or plain text arguments don't really guide users through what's available or guarantee that what you think might be available is actually implemented and available in that particular model. So that brings me to sort of halfway point. And really the point at which we started to develop TerraFERMA in response to these issues. So we wanted to be able to more easily maintain our models so that they were insulated somewhat from these API changes. We wanted to be able to compare different models a little bit easier. We also wanted to take one model and verify it and then have some confidence in another model because of that. And then we wanted to be able to share our models, output from papers with other people in an easy manner. I should have said on the previous slide, I'm just realizing, I should have said that obviously with things like the changes in the API, there are tools available that would allow you to, for instance, if you develop a model and you're happy with it, and you want to release it or freeze it, there are obviously tools out there for that, like Docker, and we had a great talk here a few weeks ago on SciUnit that allow you to share and reproduce results consistently. But that doesn't necessarily make it easier for somebody to come along and take your model and develop further upon it. They're still faced with this issue of having to backport API changes. So that leads us into TerraFERMA, what it is, and hopefully explains why we set about developing and using it. As I've said before, TerraFERMA is really a framework for rapidly developing and maintaining models, and also, I guess, just distributing it. It consists of two components, and as with everything TerraFERMA, it inherits most of its functionality from other things. So it provides a GUI called Diamond, which is actually provided through a library called SPuD that I'll talk about on the next slides. And then it provides a core library called Bucket Tools for reasons that will become obvious later. And Bucket Tools is essentially the point at which you interface with FEniCS and PETSc. So the goal here is to have users interact with TerraFERMA through the GUI, to be insulated from API changes through the Bucket Tools library, but at the end of the day, still retain that flexibility in both the definition of the equations and the solver options. And at the end of this process, TerraFERMA still generates model-specific executables, much like the FEniCS models that we saw earlier. So just going back to what SPuD is, SPuD, it was actually originally developed for the fluidity model system. It's an options management system. It stands for System for Problem Description, with a U thrown in there for an amusing name. It provides a base language to allow developers to describe the options that they want users to have access to hierarchically. That's known as a schema. It then provides a generic GUI that allows users to interact with those options. And finally, useful again to the developer, it provides a library that interfaces with the options that the user has specified by reading in their options file. From the user perspective, they interact with the GUI. It presents them with the options that are available. They set those options, and it will generate an XML-based options file that is easy to interrogate maintain as well. So just to give a very brief example, this is something that I've pulled again from the SPUD repo. From the developer's perspective, who wants to provide options to the user, they would write a document that looks like this. It's called the schema. And you can already see some of the elements of the hierarchy in this. Whoever developed this, this is apparently some sort of ballistics model where they want to be able to, the user to be able to provide a simulation name, things like the gravity and the geometry. What SPUD does is it takes this schema and populates the GUI based on it. And this is what the user interacts with. So the user sees this GUI, it's called Diamond. And you can see the sort of transference from the developer's schema on the left to the options that are now available to the user on the right. It's also, there's also inline documentation that gets put into the right-hand side panel of Diamond for the user to read. And then the user can set values and also comment on their decisions in the other panels on the right-hand side. At the end of this process, the user would save their options file in which they've set all their options and all the values of their options. And that would result in an XML file. I'm going to show this just to show that it is an XML file, but I'd like to emphasize that at no point should the user actually have to read this or look at this. But it is an XML file. And this is important because this is relatively easily maintainable. If the schema changes, there are certain updates to the schema that Diamond can automatically propagate into old options files. And if it's a change in the options tree that the schema describes that can't be automatically updated, it's very easy to provide update scripts that move things around. For instance, if gravity were to move in its location in this tree to somewhere else, it's very easy to use off-the-shelf libraries like LXML or other libraries that would allow you to update old files. So this means that the options files become somewhat more maintainable. In the context of TerraFERMA, we've just seen that SPUD is going to lay things out hierarchically. So I'm going to be saying the word hierarchical a lot for the rest of this talk. SPUD is laying things out hierarchically. So we want to figure out what the appropriate TerraFERMA hierarchy is. And this goes back to this sort of slide where we saw these different options. And if we think about the order that we need to choose those options in developing our model in, it leads to this sort of flowchart for TerraFERMA, where we want to choose things that are sort of on a global level, indented all the way to the left, like the problem geometry, any input-output options. If it's a time-dependent problem, you want to set up some time-stepping parameters. Other parameters on the sort of global level. And then we want to start thinking about the variables. So TerraFERMA thinks about everything in terms of systems of equations. So you'll see the word system come up a lot. So these are systems of equations, and a system of equations is like in the convection example, the velocity, pressure, and temperature that we saw. So the three equations for those three fields. So a system is going to consist of a set of fields. Each field is going to require some sort of discretization. Because we're in finite element land, that means we're going to have to select the element that we're solving, that we're discretizing that field on. Fields generally require initial conditions, or at least initial guesses, and boundary conditions. And then the system might require other coefficients that are needed. For instance, the Rayleigh number in the convection example. And then we want the user to be able to provide, for instance, the equations to be solved, and then solver tolerances and other options describing that solver, and finally any diagnostic functionals. So this slide is a little wordy. A sort of more visual way of looking at that would be that we have these sort of global options surrounding everything in pink. We have then systems, which are the systems of equations in this sort of gold color. And beneath systems, we have these fields, coefficients, solvers, and functionals. And if we open up Diamond with the TerraFERMA schema, we can see that hierarchy laid out in the options that Diamond presents us with. So we have geometry, input-output options, time-stepping, some global parameters, this thing called a system, these systems of equations. System has the option to have a field in it. This plus here indicates that we can add more fields to it. We can have coefficients. And then we have a nonlinear solver where we can specify things like the equations. So here we have a space to specify the residual. So going back to our convection example, I'm just going to talk you through setting up what the user perspective would be, setting up this convection example using TerraFERMA through the Diamond GUI. So I'm going to start with a blank options file. The first thing to notice is that on the left-hand side, we have our tree of options. Some options are in black, meaning they are complete. And some options are in blue, indicating that the user still has to fill things out. So I'm going to assume that we have already set the geometry, the input, output, and the time-stepping options. And I'm going to name our system by typing a name in here I'm going to name it convection. So if I do that, you see that these options have turned black because I've magically filled them out. And our system now has this name, convection. I'm then going to work my way down as a user of this. I'm going to work my way down this tree of options. First of all, I'm going to tell it what mesh I'm going to be on, and that's something that I defined before in the geometry section. I'm going to give this system of equations a UFL symbol to represent the variables within that system of equations. So I'm going to call it U in exactly the same way as I defined U earlier to be this vector of our unknowns, the velocity, the pressure, and the temperature. Speaking of the velocity, pressure, and the temperature, we're going to need to add three fields to our system. So that was me just scrolling up a little bit. So now you can see that the system is at the top, and I'm going to add these three fields, and I've already named them velocity, pressure, and temperature. But you can see that they're still blue, so there's some more information that they're demanding of me. And if I step through those, this one has now turned black because I have filled in its initial condition and boundary conditions. I've told it that it's going to be discretized on a P2 element. And I've given it the UFL symbol V, just like we were earlier in the convection example. I'm going to show you filling out some of these initial and boundary conditions on the temperature in a little bit. I'm not doing it now because the velocity isn't that interesting in terms of initial condition. So now we go down to the pressure. I've given it the UFL symbol P. As you can see, it's got an initial condition that I've filled out before we got here. And then I'm going to move on to the temperature, UFL symbol T. I'm going to tell it that it's going to be a piecewise quadratic element, P2 quadratic. And I'm going to give it an initial condition, which I'm going to do using a snippet of Python that I write directly into the options file here. I'm then going to provide the temperature with some boundary conditions, which again, I can activate and turn on here and then enter the value. For instance, here, the value at the bottom is going to be 1. So after we've defined the fields, we can collapse the fields back down again, and we want to define any coefficients, in this case, the Rayleigh number. So I'm going to give it the UFL symbol RA, appropriately enough. And then we're going to move on to the solver. So the solver, the nonlinear solver, actually allows us to specify in it the forms using the UFL language again. And here I've entered it again here. It's a little uglier than before because there's some word wrapping going on, line wrapping going on. But this is exactly the same text as you saw earlier on the previous slide corresponding to this. So we have our residual for the velocity, pressure, and temperature, and the overall residual at the bottom of our little script. You'll notice here that I'm using some symbols that I don't appear to have defined. So for instance, I'm using this syntax again where underscore t means the test function, underscore I means the most up-to-date function, underscore n means the previous time step. And what TerraFERMA has done is it's taken the symbols that we defined, and it's taken the symbols that we have defined. We defined a U, a V, a P, a T, and it has automatically created these underscore I, underscore N, underscore T, and underscore A variables to allow us to enter these equations using the weak form. If we carry on, we can again use the same syntax to enter the, to program in the derivative, to define the Jacobian. And we also have a different preconditioner for this problem. I didn't show you this UFL earlier, but we can use UFL to define that Jacobian preconditioner. And at this stage, we have defined everything we need to discretize and describe this equation. So these matrices that we saw earlier. And all that's left is that we need to tell it how it's going to solve this problem. So if we carry on down the options tree, TerraFERMA approaches assumes every problem is nonlinear, even if it's linear. That's because most of the problems we tackle are actually nonlinear problems, and you can solve a linear problem just taking one iteration of a nonlinear solver. So it's going to ask us for the error, you know, our errors, our desired relative error and absolute error on our nonlinear solver. We can put those in here, and then we can move down to the linear solver. And opening up that branch of our options tree, we can see that this is defaulted to GMRes and SOR, which we don't want to use. So instead, I'm just going to scroll up and I'm going to switch those to FGMRes and field split. And I'm going to go through and populate this in exactly the same way as we saw with the field split example earlier. That slide should not be there. Picking up again, I'm going to go through and populate these options in exactly the same way as I showed you earlier. So we've dropped down the menu for the field split. We have now defined a field split for the temperature based on the field temperature. We defined a field split for the Stokes based on the field's velocity and pressure. And we're going to carry on for that Stokes block to define a solver, FGMRes field split. And again, within that, there are another two field splits. So what you can see here is that this structure exactly resembles at least the first three levels. I couldn't fit the fourth level on the screen. At least the first three levels of that preconditioning field split example we showed earlier. And at the end of this process, what the user should have done, so the user will probably go on then after doing that to maybe define any functionals they're interested in seeing as output. But at the end of that process, what you end up with here is a file where all the lines are black, indicating to the user that this is complete as far as the schema is aware. This user has also here defined two functionals for the VRMS velocity and also another system of equations, which appears just by this name to be solving for a current number. So at this stage, the user has completely filled out an options file. And what I'd like to just talk about now quickly, because I'm aware that we're at 45 minutes, is what happens on the back end of this? What turns this options file into a usable piece of software, usable model? So what does that is what's the TerraFERMA core library, which is called bucket tools. And this is a hierarchical, again, the word hierarchical, tree of C++ classes, starting with one called the bucket, hence the name bucket tools, which can contain many system buckets, which in turn can contain many function solver and functional buckets. So again, what you see here is this repeat of this hierarchy of options from the global level to the system level, and down to the field function or field and coefficient solver and functional level. If you were to develop TerraFERMA, what you would also find is that there are these derived classes from the main classes that are responsible for interacting with SPUD and reading the options file and populating the members of these main classes. So the point of this main library is really to insulate users from changes in the API of the underlying FEniCS and PETSc libraries. So this library interacts both with the options file through SPUD and with FEniCS and PETSc through their interfaces. And if their interfaces change, this library changes, and those API changes are propagated to all your models, not without requiring any backporting across different scripts. So from a sort of workflow perspective, a user will complete an options file, just like we just worked through. That options file will then be used by TerraFERMA to generate an application-specific library, which will be combined with the bucket tools library on the left-hand side here, which is the part that interacts with FEniCS and PETSc, and combine these two libraries with a very lightweight main.cpp, which is the entirety of the main.cpp for TerraFERMA. It initializes bucket tools, it fills a bucket based on these options, and then it runs the bucket before returning. And so the combination of these two libraries with this main.cpp results in an application-specific executable that the user can run. From the user perspective, sitting in front of a terminal, they are going to open up Diamond and open up an options file. You'll notice that the suffix on this options file is TFML, which stands for TerraFERMA Markup Language, so it's just an XML that obeys the rules of the schema. So the user is going to open up Diamond, open up convection.tfml, populate that with their options, and then again in the terminal, they're going to want to build an executable from that. In this case, I'm going to demonstrate, just show this using CMake. So they're going to make a build directory, change into that build directory, supply the options file to CMake, and build it. Or because that line there using CMake is a little difficult to remember, we provide a script for that where we just call tfbuild on the input options file and make that application-specific executable. Once the executable is built, the user can just run it. By default, it will be called TerraFERMA, and they can supply the input options file to it. Or we provide a shortcut for that, a shortcut makefile target. Just they can type make run, and it will run that executable with that options file. So that's the user sort of workflow perspective. We provide some other tools that are also useful for the user. The main one is this, we have a simulation harness. This is another SPUD-based system for running suites of models. It is essentially, so the user will fill out their TFML, their options file for TerraFERMA, and then if they want to run a suite of models, say varying a parameter, they can fill out this other XML, this SHML, and in this example here, I'm just showing it where it's interacting and setting the Rayleigh number in the convection example that we were doing earlier. If they write this SHML, then they would again open the SHML using Diamond and run the model just using the TF simulation harness --- run and then this SHML file. So that's another way of doing what we were seeing on the previous slides in terms of this workflow. But it requires another file. We also provide Python modules and some plotting tools for interacting with the model's diagnostic output. And finally, and really importantly, we provide update scripts for options files. So the bucket tools library is there to insulate users from API changes. But let's say there's some change that actually requires us to change the schema. Then we provide these update scripts that update old options files. And that is relatively easy to do because of the XML structure of these files and the fact that they can be validated against the current schema. TerraFERMA, one of the goals is that it provides some confidence in your model output, given some previous model output. To that end, we have a lot of regression tests, which are mostly manufactured solution convergence tests. We also run a suite of benchmarks, and we do this on several platforms to try to cover our bases in terms of building it on clusters. There are a few resources that are available. There's a wiki and a GitHub repo online. There's a tutorial cookbook, which is also available through the wiki. And there's a paper in G-Cubed that discusses many of the things that I've discussed here today, and that's also available through the wiki. So that leads us to sort of the issues with TerraFERMA, and this is where I kind of hope to open it up a bit to discussion. I hope I'm in time to do that. So one of the main issues is that TerraFERMA has a lot of dependencies. It's sort of intrinsic in its design. TerraFERMA is actually itself quite lightweight. Most of the functionality of that core library is reading the options files and setting up the problem a bit, but it passes a lot of its functionality to FEniCS and PETSc. So a lot of its dependencies actually come from the underlying libraries, which means that if they're difficult to install, TerraFERMA is difficult to install. One of those dependencies is obviously SPUD, and that frustratingly adds a GTK dependency to TerraFERMA so that we can open up the Diamond GUI. And that's fine if you're working on your own machine, or it's normally fine if you're working on your own machine. It gets a bit more complicated with things like if you're trying to put this into a Docker container. It is possible, but it is challenging to open up Windows from a Docker container. So my sort of fantasy land wish list would include developing a sort of SPUD 2.0, which might be written instead of using GTK, be written using JavaScript, and allow you to interact with option systems through a web browser rather than through this GTK GUI. There are features I would like to add to TerraFERMA. Its assumption of a two-level time-stepping scheme is a limitation for some of my models, particularly in the multi-phase simulations. So I am working on introducing improved time-stepping algorithms. We're also looking at the Leo part. I don't know if I'm saying that right. The Leo part library for particle advection, which is itself built on FEniCS to allow us to have particles within TerraFERMA. And also, because we're so reliant on these field split preconditioners for our multi-physics problems, we're interested in better memory management for that. There are also several things that just need to be upgraded. The underlying libraries haven't been upgraded in a while since we haven't needed any of the new functionality. That also requires an upgrade to our Python, which is hopefully being pushed out in the next couple of weeks. And also there are things like we developed our BuildBot, our testing framework, 5 or 6 years ago using a BuildBot framework. There are some more modern alternatives to that for continuous integration now. And there are also some design decisions that were made, 5 years ago that could be questioned now. So like I said before, it uses the C++ interface. That's fine for most things. In some cases, I think it makes it a bit easier when you're interacting with clusters and large parallel simulations, but it has limited us in terms of being able to, for instance, switch from FEniCS to trying out FireDrake, which shares an API, or mostly shares an API with FEniCS, but is an entirely Python-based library. So I'll either leave it now, either with these conclusions or the issues I just highlighted. Conclusions generally are that these open source numerical software libraries are incredibly powerful tools. They're really fantastic in terms of how how flexible they are and how we can come up with new problems and introduce new problems very easily. But they do pose certain challenges for maintaining, reliably maintaining and sharing models, multiphysics models. So TerraFERMA tries to address some of these by providing a framework that tries to shield the user from underlying API changes. Also, as new features are added to TerraFERMA, all models, old and new, gain access to them without any need for backporting to different scripts. The tutorials, tests, and benchmarks not only test TerraFERMA, but also provide what I hope is a library of input files on which to base new models. And hopefully the sharing of some of that common infrastructure, like the implementation of boundary conditions, means that testing one model helps to increase trust in another. And I will leave it with the massive caveat that there is still plenty of scope for user error when you are allowing users to specify the equations in the options file. Okay, so thank you very much. That's me done. And I should add that I'd be very happy to take any questions, either using the microphone or through the chat window.
I'll start out with a quick question. Two quick questions. One, is this available in a Docker container if we want to skip the installation and just try running a few models?
It is, yes. It is available in a Docker container with instructions on the wiki for getting that. The instructions on the wiki also cover how you open Diamond from within the Docker container. But that is sometimes a tripping up point for some people.
Second question. And so then between going from FEniCS to PETSc, are there any issues with scaling on large clusters, or is it pretty much seamless at this point?
In my experience, it's pretty much seamless at this point. FEniCS, even in that example that I showed at the start for Poisson, where we just handed it off to this wonderful solve interface, FEniCS is actually using in its back end, it's using PETSc. It was one of the reasons that we originally implemented all of this in C++ was that we wanted access to some features of PETSc that weren't available through FEniCS. But because FEniCS is using PETSc itself, a lot of this is seamless, I tend to find.
That's amazing. Problem the weak form right to large scale scaling. That's amazing.
Yeah. No, it's really fantastic. Yeah.
Other questions? It looks like there is one.
Oh, great. Okay. So I'll just read this out in case people are watching this on YouTube afterwards. So Rene says, I feel that we are through a similar journey with Aspect, just from the opposite starting point. We started with a more or less uniform code and added more and more options for users to load individual plugins. Do you think there is a sweet spot for having prepared or provided models versus full flexibility of building your own? I hope there's a sweet spot. I'm not quite sure where it is, to be honest with you. So my start in geodynamics was through the fluidity model, which I helped to develop. And that was one of these, it is one of these sort of mammoth, everything internal, you want to add an option, you want to add a different constitutive law, you have to implement it. That's a great model. That's worked for a long time. There's a great degree of reliability in that. You can test things and know that the user isn't going to mess it up. And that's fantastic, and that still works great for me in fluidity. And at the other end of the spectrum, you obviously have the pure FEniCS approach, where it's kind of hard to test things between different models. Now, is there a sweet spot? I think I'd hope TerraFERMA moves towards that sweet spot. But, you know, if you were willing to limit yourself to a certain set of equations, you could certainly, you know, you would throw away some of your flexibility by choosing a certain set of equations. You could still have an options tree that interacted with FEniCS in a very, you know, still flexible way that might be more reliable still. And I should say that even moving from a pure FEniCS model to a sort of TerraFERMA-esque model, a framework model, you know, we have thrown away a lot of the flexibility of FEniCS. We are exposing the functionality that we want from FEniCS in TerraFERMA, but if it's not exposed, it's, you know, it's not really available to the user. So I hope that answers your question. John is saying in the chat, TerraFERMA is incredibly appealing from the standpoint of trying out new multiphysics problems. In terms of getting started with new problems, say coupling porous media flow with elasticity, is going through FEniCS example the best place to start? I personally use both approaches. You know, I will play with things in a pure FEniCS model. Particularly if, you know, if it's a piece of functionality that I know I don't quite have available in TerraFERMA yet, I will play with it in the FEniCS model. So for instance, these particles that we've been looking at, you know, we're playing with them purely on sort of outside of TerraFERMA at the moment. If it's something that I know is available in TerraFERMA, I will start straight away in TerraFERMA. And if it's something that I find that I like outside of TerraFERMA, I will try to implement it within TerraFERMA, because then it becomes available to all of my models. So it depends what I'm doing, and it kind of depends whether I know what I want to do is available in TerraFERMA or not. So Ravi is asking, thanks for the nice introduction. A generic question, how easy is it to set up problems with a curvilinear domain, e.g. initial adaptive mesh, maybe even triangular tetrahedral meshes? What about importing more complex boundary, e.g. faults, assuming that has to be specified at the FEniCS level? Yes, so that's one of the nice things about talking about this sort of framework is that you can blame everything on the underlying libraries. But that is something that is challenging at the curvilinear domains are challenging at the moment in FEniCS. But having said that, FEniCS is currently undergoing an upgrade, which is one of the reasons I haven't updated TerraFERMA recently, because I'm kind of hoping that I can just jump to that upgraded version. During that upgrade, which is partially available already, curvilinear domains are available within that. I believe they're already available in FireDrake, but I'd have to check that out. In terms of adaptive meshes, there is some functionality for that in FEniCS. It is not exposed in TerraFERMA at the moment, but it is something that could be exposed in TerraFERMA and made available to all the models from TerraFERMA. In terms of importing more complex boundaries, I would actually say that's something for your mesh generator. If you can describe it in a mesh generator and have that mesh generator output in a format that FEniCS or TerraFERMA can read in, then there's not much of an issue with complex boundaries. Great. So John is asking, are there any good examples of gradient plasticity problems in FEniCS? I am not actually sure. I know that there are some elasticity problems in FEniCS. I don't know. I'm going to have to punt on that question. I don't know whether there are any using gradient plasticity. The FEniCS demos are a wonderful place to start. but it's a reasonably limited set of actual functioning demos. You know, it's things like Poisson and mixed Poisson. And, you know, there's a Navier-Stokes demo, and there is an elasticity demo. But in terms of what people are using it for, I think you'd have to ask the FEniCS community see if anybody is doing that and was willing to share that sort of problem with you. So yeah, I'm happy to take more questions if there are any. John is also asking in the chat.
Going once, going twice. Anyone else? Well, if not, I'm sure, Cian, I'm sure you don't mind if people email you questions directly afterwards as well.
Yes, I'd be happy to take them. And as I understand it, this will be available on YouTube if anybody wants to go back and look at it.
Absolutely. And if you're interested, I'm not sure if we have one, but we could put a TerraFERMA subforum on the Aspect community forums if that's of interest at some point.
Yeah, we should talk about that. That would be interesting. We do have a Slack channel. It's mostly populated by the principal users, which is us, Mark Spiegelman, Peter Van Kaken, and others. But that is, I think, publicly available and should be linked to from the wiki somewhere.
Great. Well, thank you again, Cian. That was fantastic.
Well, thank you very much for the opportunity. And thank you all for logging in and listening.